It is important to understand, for instance, that one of the reasons that pigs do not live up to their potential is because there might be some pathogens in the gut. So making sure that you can deal properly with these pathogens and keeping gut healthy might be a way to enhance the sustainability and come at the benefit of both the piglets, the producer, and the environment. Mr. Lannot will tell all about it.
Thank you very much, Vincent, for this very nice introduction. I'm very glad to be part of this webinar, and especially I would like to talk to you indeed about gut health. And not only gut health as such, and we will go over the definition, but after definition, I will take you all through the farrowing house, where we have a look at how can we install a good gut health in our piglets. We will see this from a general point of view, but also then how NuScience approaches this. After we have installed this gut health, we will go to the weaning phase, because at that moment gut health is coming under pressure, and we will have a closer look how can we approach this and how can we maintain a healthy gut also after weaning without using any zinc oxide or antibiotics. Let's start with a definition, and here I would like the help of the audience, because I have here a nice poll, Vincent.
Okay, there we go. The question is, what determines a good gut health? Is that a matter of microflora? Do you think it's a matter of gut morphology, mucosa integrity, or D, all of the above? Well, we've started the poll and the first answers are coming in. And so far they're very unanimous, as far as I can see. The answer D is the winner here.
So far,
okay.
It was indeed what I expected. If we would have had a webinar for microbiologists, it would have been answer A. Yeah. If it would have been physiologists, it would have been answer C. Anatomists go for the answer B. But thank God we are here with the industry.
Yeah,
and they know that.
Just to give you an idea, it's, there's a 98% of the answers went for answer D. So
what I expected. Mm. And that is also what we believe. Gut health is a fragile balance. It's a balance between, on the one hand, microflora, mucose integrity, and gut morphology. Now, what do these terms mean? And microflora, this is actually the combination of groups of bacteria that are living inside the intestine. A piglet is not born with a microflora. No, the microflora is coming in very shortly after birth. And as you can see in the science literature review from 2015, you will see there is a fragile balance in the first weeks. And there is some shift, not too much, but all of a sudden, at day 28, you see a very big shift in the microflora. This is induced by stress and a big feed change, what we call the weaning period. This about microflora. If we have a look at mucose integrity, there is two other important parts. First of all, we have the tight junctions. Tight junctions are polypeptides who bind the intestinal epithelial cells together and make sure nothing passes in between these cells. No pathogens, no toxins can go and infect the animal. On the other hand side, we have a mucus layer, also important for the mucose integrity. This mucus layer is produced by the goblet cells. And the more goblet cells we have, and the better health they are, the thicker the mucus layer will be. All this, again, influenced by stress, inflammation, and feed. We were talking already about cells, which leads us to gut morphology. And important in gut morphology are two things. First of all, we have the villi, and mainly the length of the villi will be important, because the longer these villi will be, the more contact there will be with the feet, and the more digestion there will be, less substrate will be available for dysbiosis, coming back again to microflora. On the other hand, we also have the crypts. The crypts, you can look at crypts as factories which produce enterocytes. The thicker these crypts are, the more enterocytes are produced, the longer the villi will grow. This is very important in the installation of gut health. Then we want a lot of enterocytes to be produced, but this also costs a lot of energy. So once these villi are long enough, we would prefer to maintain these long villi without too much turnover of enterocytes, because then we want to spare energy. Again, also gut morphology influenced by stress, inflammation, and feed. Okay, let's go to the farrowing house and look at gut health in the farrowing house. Now, if you look at microflora in the Faring house, it all starts, if you, like you can see in this graph, at the moment zero. At that moment, there is actually no microflora inside the piglet. But you see, in a very short time, and within hours, and then also days and weeks, but within hours, microflora is going inside the piglet. At that moment, it is very fragile, and so then trying to come up with a steady microflora, it will be the most important focus. Now, to install a very good microflora, there is a lot of different things that can be of influence. I have grouped them into three parts: nutritional influences, farm management influences, and veterinary management influences. In nutritional, we have, of course, the feed of the piglet, but don't forget also the diet of the sow can be very important. Farm management, if the piglet comes in contact with the environment of the farrowing house, it is important that we there have a very clean environment, that we have a good bird process, so that the piglets are in a very good condition in the first hours of their life. And on the other hand, we also have the veterinary management. What vaccinations are given? What antibiotics are given inside these feeds, as well of sows and piglets? So these three parts are very important. Now, looking at gut morphology in the farrowing house, then we see a very remarkable thing. At day zero, as you can see in this table, and the villi length of the small intestine is very limited. We see an enormous growth in the first 3 days, up to twofold, almost threefold growth of the villi length, and this is influenced by colostrum. In the colostrum, there are some prebiotic components that really induce the growth of the villi length, and you see in 3 days, these villi grow very fast. After day three, it is important to maintain this villi growth or even increase it, so that our morphology of the gut is in optimal condition to come up to the very stressful situation at weaning. And that you can see after weaning, you see the decrease in villi length. This is what we want to prevent. And how can we do that? We have to train these animals to eat solid feed. Only this way we can influence the villi length. If we have a good feed intake before weaning with the right gut maturation components, then we can truly influence the villi length. Now, how does NuScience approaches this installation of gut health in the farrowing house? Therefore, everybody knows our strong brand Babito, part of the Babi lines. And inside the Babito, there is a lot of substances that improve gut maturation. This gut maturation, microflora, mucose integrity, and gut morphology, we really have some excellent components, innovative components inside. But you can put whatever you want inside the feed. If you don't have a good feed intake, they will never reach the gut, and they will never be able to play their role. And so this is a second strong pillar of Babito. We focus on feed intake. Now, gut maturation. How is Babito maturing the gut? We have some very innovative components inside, which we call prebiotic milk oligosaccharides. Yes, indeed, derived from milk, just like in the colostrum of the sow, there is a prebiotic components inside. Also inside Babito, we use these kind of products. And these prebiotic milk oligosaccharides will have an effect on the microbiota, will also have an effect on the morphology of the gut. And this can be seen very nicely in this trial performed at the University of John Blue, where we can compare piglets who had a control feed with piglets who had a crib feed with PMO, like the Babito. There you see we have deeper crypts, so more production of enterocytes and longer villi, up to 10% longer villi inside the intestine. Next to that, you also see a very good effect with more lactic acid-producing bacteria and a lower amount of enterococcus bacteria. And this truly shows that Babito accelerates intestinal maturation. But not only the maturation, also the feed intake is something of constant importance and a constant constantly at our attention in the Babito, because it is proven that some complex diets, and with complex diet we mean diets containing heat-treated cereals, high digestible proteins, very tasteful lactose sources. By using these complex diets, we don't not only increase the amount of feed intake in piglets, but also the amount of piglets that are eating. And this is very nicely shown in this scientific study. And besides that, we also constantly try to improve the feed intake of the Balvito. For example, 2 years ago, we updated the recipe at Eurotier. Why? Because indeed, we want, even though we had already very good feed intake with more than 470 grams before the weaning, even this we would like to improve, or we wanted to improve. And with adapting, we reached up to 500 grams of feed intake. Always taking into account the growth performance of the piglets after weaning. Also, this is tested when we do a trial with Babito. We always look at the performance after weaning, because that's why we do it for. That's why we try to install the gut health. Okay, after installing the gut health, then all of a sudden comes the moment of weaning. What happens? You all know. Separation from the sow, transport, climate change, a lot of managerial changes, also diet changes. No more milk. This is a very big thing. Even if you give the same feed before as after weaning, 90% of the feed changes because there's no more milk. The drink water. All of a sudden, they have to look for drink water elsewhere. They don't find it immediately. New pathogens inside the sable. Diseases, parasites, some vaccinations. All these things, so as well nutritional, managerial, as veterinarial changes, lead to metabolic reactions. Oxidative stress, dysbiosis, inflammation, systemic immune reactions, degradation of the villi, all having a huge impact on our gut health, and giving symptoms like diarrhea, leaky gut, energy loss, nutrient loss, lower feed conversion, growth retardations, dehydrations, all things that we don't want, even mortality. Now, how did we prevent this before? Zinc oxide and antibiotics. This is how we did it. But today is 2018, and we're talking here on the webinar on sustainable livestock. This is not the way how we will proceed in the future. And therefore, new science has developed a new program. Which is the Aim for Zero program, and it's not just a product that we want to provide you. No, it is much more. It is a total program in which we try to give our clients the possibility to have new nutritional trends, to have a look at new nutritional trends, and we want them to have a tailor-made advice for their own situation, and at the end, there is the ability to use safe and innovative health concepts. Now, how do we do this? First of all, we start with a digital benchmark tool. What do I mean with a digital benchmark tool? You contact your new science advisor, or you write an email to aimforzero@newsciencegroup.com, and then you will have access to this digital benchmark tool containing 30 questions. Questions about health, questions about management, questions about nutrition. From this questionnaire, you will receive afterwards an Aim for Zero report. In this Aim for Zero report, you will have the ability to benchmark with colleagues, with a similar situation, for example, similar weaning age, similar region, or a more global report, just as you want. And you will be able to discuss this report with your new science specialists. Now, Vincent, it might be good if we have give the people a flavor on what I mean with a benchmark, and to do this with this poll.
Okay, there we go. What kind of crude protein is optimal after weaning? I'm starting the poll here. Is that more than 18.5? Is that between 17.5 and 18.5? Is that between 16.5 and 17.5? Or is that below 16.5? The lines are open. Let's see what the results are, and they're coming in. And I see a slight tendency towards answer C so far. I'll let it run for a couple of more seconds, and then I think we'll have a winner. Yeah, I think answer C, between 16.5 and 17.5, is the is the winner with about 56% of the of the votes.
56%. That means there's also a lot of people using other values.
Yeah.
And actually, there is no right answer to this question. With only this question, you can conclude nothing.
The last one, the D answer, below 16.5, they didn't get any, and they didn't get any votes at all. So
that is then also, of course, truly at the low side. But we see also there in certain regions, and that crude protein levels lower than 16.5 are used. But like I said, there is no true answer here. No, you have to look at the complete situation. And that is why you need the whole report, where you can look at your own results on health, your own results on farm management and on nutritional levels, and compare yourself with your colleagues. You also receive an average score, and the average score based on our new science standards. And from there, a discussion can start. Okay, how can we improve? What else can we do to improve the general gut health around weaning? Of course, together with the new science specialist, we will come to an optimal solution. And from this optimal solution, then we can look at what can we provide to the customer in order to come to an situation where we don't have to use any zinc oxide, where we don't have to use any antibiotics. And therefore, we developed a new and innovative safety concept naming Vita Zero. Vita Zero is actually creating an exogenous defense shield. And now, what do I mean with an exogenous defense shield? This is really a shield that we place inside the intestine of the piglet, and this way we avoid the piglet's own immunity, its endogenous defense shield, to get activated. If this endogenous immunity is not activated, we spare a lot of energy, that energy can then later on be used for growth. Now, how do we create this exogenous defense shield? This has a four-way mode of action. First of all, we are able to kill bacteria, not only kill them, but kill them at a very early stage, mainly in the stomach. On the other hand, there's also a possibility, there is also a mode of action which captures bacteria and simply wash them out of the system before they can attack the enterocytes. We have a mode of action that fortifies the gut barrier, so mucose integrity, and there is a product inside that really block toxins in this way that they cannot adhere to their receptors. Now, if you look at killing bacteria, how do we do this? We are new science, we are known for medium-chain fatty acids. We have a balanced concept of medium-chain fatty acids inside Vita Zero, which are truly active against main pathogens around weaning. And why are we already for years now focusing so much on these medium-chain fatty acids? Because it is the organic acid which has the highest antimicrobial activity, up to tenfold higher than most commonly used organic acids. This way, it is possible that we can stabilize the intestinal microflora because the activity is very early on stomach level. Second thing, capturing bacteria and toxins by making use of a specific prebiotic fiber. There is an agglutination of pathogens. You can see this very nice on these pictures drawn from a microscope. And when we add this Vita Zero with this prebiotic fiber, E. coli is actually clotted together and simply washed out the system before the E. coli can harm the enterocytes. And this gives a reduced risk of pathogenic overgrowth and, of course, positive effect on the immunity and gut integrity by excreting the endotoxins. Then, third mode of action is fortifying the gut barrier with a natural antioxidant. How does this work? And you can see this very nice in the Boyden chamber, which is drawn at the right-hand side of the slide. When we add macromolecules, and on top of a monolayer of enterocytes, we can measure how many of these macromolecules really pass through the monolayer of enterocytes and come inside of the serosal site. If we do this in a normal situation without oxidative stress, you can see in the graph that there is really a low permeability of this monolayer. The macromolecules are not passing through. If we add oxidative stress by the mean of peroxide, for example, then we see the tight junctions of this monolayer are broken, and the macromolecules are able to pass through this monolayer. So the gut integrity is really broken here. When we add, besides this oxidative stress, also Vita Zero, we see that we can preserve these tight junctions and that they are still functioning very well. So also this is part of the Vita Zero concept. And then last, but certainly not least, because this is our most innovative fraction inside the Vita Zero, we have another health fiber fraction, which can truly block endotoxins, lipopolysaccharides. It really protects the receptors of being attached towards the lipopolysaccharides. And this way, the activation of the immune system by producing cytokines is prohibited. If we don't produce cytokines, there is no inflammation of the intestine. And so there will be less neutrophils attracted towards the intestine. This inflammation normally leads to a depressed feed intake, to retarded growth. And this is a situation that we would like to preserve. And you can very nicely see this in an in vivo trial that we performed with a negative control. We fed the piglets a few days after weaning. Another group which was fed the same feed, but added with E. coli lipopolysaccharides. And the third group was fed E. coli lipopolysaccharides together with Vita Zero. If we, after 5 days, kill the piglets and look in the intestine how many neutrophils are truly attracted towards the intestine, and then we see in the negative control, and there's not so much neutrophils attracted, a huge increase in neutrophils with the lipopolysaccharide group. And by adding Vita Zero, we are able to reduce these neutrophils with 77%. So a reduced activation of the immune system leads to an improved gut health. I want to conclude with a nice in vivo trial performed in Spain and an independent research facility where we fed piglets with a basal diet, zinc oxide, by the way, crude protein level 18%, and another group with the Vita Zero, same diet, only the zinc oxide was replaced by Vita Zero. Now, what did we see? Mainly, first days after weaning, we see a significant effect on feed intake. And from day 2 to day 4, and we saw a significant higher feed intake in the Vita Zero group. We all know zinc oxide is not the most tasteful product, but there's also a danger inside. There's also something like overeating, which creates diarrhea. But if we look at the presence of diarrhea, in this case, this was not the case. Here we see only 1% of diarrhea in the Vita Zero group with 3% in the zinc oxide group. Overall performance of the animals was also better, as well in the weaning diet as in the starter diet in the zinc in the Vita Zero group. Okay, if you want to join the Aim for Zero program, please don't hesitate, or you contact your New Science advisor, or you mail us to aimforzero@newsciencegroup.com. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Lano. Thank you very much for your presentation. I enjoyed listening to it, and I saw there is a long, long list of things that are incorporated in the Vita Zero concept, coming from a situation where we provided the animals with zinc oxide or antibiotics. Don't you think that with reducing so many possibilities to maintain gut health, that we've made life very difficult for ourselves?
You can look at it this way, but on the other hand side, I don't think there is a golden bullet to replace zinc oxide or antibiotic. You have to come from different angles. So you talk about Vita Zero as one thing, but also looking at your nutritional values and your formulation, and looking at your farm management, looking at your veterinary management. I think you have to come from all different angles at the same time if you truly want to have a sustainable livestock feeling.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that I wanted to mention, that in terms of sustainability, of course, I guess that getting rid of antibiotics and zinc oxide is a good thing.
Absolutely. If you have read the reports of the World Health Organization, antimicrobial resistance will be death cause number one in humans. And so if we don't start doing something here, and that's not only in animal feed. Human medicines also have to change, but this will be a focus, and you see it happening all over the world. It's not anymore the Netherlands and Western Europe. No, no, it's already the whole of Europe. In China, they have already prohibited cholestina and zinc oxide. Also in the USA, the restriction is getting high. So this will be focus point of the coming years, absolutely.
Okay, there's no escaping on that. Thank you very much for your presentation.